welcome as we gather to celebrate this third Sunday in the season of Advent. It is the season of waiting, a season of anticipation, and as we have talked about hope and peace, today we talk about joy. I remind you that as we worship today, we have an opportunity to share together in some community art. If you are the kind who needs something to do with your hands so that your ears can listen better, we do have our art piece in the back that we invite you to be a part of as we worship today. You're welcome to do that during worship. You're welcome to do that after worship and contribute some color to our piece of art. As we gather today, I am so grateful for you to be here at Wesley Chapel, where neighbors find their place in God's family. As we worship today, I invite us to stand together and join in the opening prayer that is printed in our bulletin. God of justice and peace, from the heavens, you rain down mercy and kindness that all on earth may stand in awe and wonder before your marvelous deeds. Raise our heads in expectation that we may yearn for the coming day of the Lord and stand without blame before your Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. I invite us to continue to lift our voices together with our theme hymn for the season of Advent. It is People Look East. It is number 202 in our Blue United Methodist hymnal. And we'll sing all the verses this morning. Seated. I invite you, as Daryl and Mary Elena come forward to light the Advent wreath, I invite you to have your Black Faith We Sing hymnal open to number 2090. We will continue with singing the Light the Advent Candle song, and then be prepared in your bulletin to share in the congregational responses they read.
God's people were surrounded by hardship, suffering, and grief. Isaiah proclaimed, "The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim the liberty to the captives, and to release the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord, favor, and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn in Zion, to give them a garland instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of a faint spirit."
We come today as people who are also surrounded by suffering and grief, and yet the Spirit hovers among us, tending and anointing us, inspiring freedom where there is captivity, declaring blessing in places the world has cursed, and igniting fierce joy where mourning and heartache prevail.
We wait as people who experience hardship and pain, yet we are called to witness to the persistent joy that sustains our life as God's people.
We light these candles as signs of our shocking hope, just peace and fierce joy. May our lives shine with the fierce, tenacious joy of the light that shines in our hearts as we wait and work for the coming of God's kingdom on earth as it is in heaven.
Let us sing the first three voices of hymn 2090 in the faith we sing, Light the Advent Candle.
Good morning. Good morning. Old Testament scriptures, Isaiah 61, verses 1 through 4, and then 8 through 11. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and release to the prisoners. Proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to provide for those who mourn in Zion, to give them a garland instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of faint spirit. They will be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord to display his glory. They shall build up the ancient ruins. They shall raise up the former devastation. They shall repair the ruined cities, the devastations of many generations. For I, the Lord, love justice. I hate robbery and wrongdoing. I will faithfully give them their recompense, and I will make an everlasting covenant with them. Their descendants shall be known among the nations, and their offspring among the peoples. All who see them shall acknowledge that they are a people whom the Lord has blessed. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My whole being shall exult in my God, for he has clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decks himself with a garland, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels. For as the earth brings forth its shoots, and as a garden causes what is sown in it to spring up, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to spring up before all the nations. The gospel reading today is from John chapter 1, verses 6 through 8, and then 19 through 28. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. This is the testimony given by John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you?" He confessed and did not deny it, but he confessed, "I am not the Messiah." They asked him, "What then? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." Then they said to him, "Who are you? Let us have an answer for those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" He said, "I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as the prophet Isaiah said." Now they had been sent from the Pharisees. They asked him, "Why then are you baptizing if you are neither the Messiah, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?" John answered them, I baptize with water. Among you stands one whom you do not know, the one who is coming after me. I am not worthy to untie the strap of his sandal." This took place in Bethany across the Jordan, where John was baptizing. The word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Let's pray. Gracious and holy God, it is a gift to gather here in this place. And while it is cold and wet and dreary outside, it is warm here. It is dry, and we are gathered as your people. So open our minds to a new knowing, a new understanding of your word. Open our eyes to see the world around us as you see it. Open our ears to hear you calling us as your people. And open our hearts to understand a more full measure of your grace, of your love that came down at Christmas. We ask this in the name of Jesus, the one who is and was and forevermore shall be. Amen. Joy to the world, the Lord is. is come. Let earth receive her King. Now, some of us have been waiting, maybe patiently or not so patiently, to sing that hymn in worship, haven't we? And it's the third Sunday of Advent, the Sunday when we talk about joy. So today seems like the perfect day to sing joy to the world, doesn't it? Well, we're going to have to wait one more week, my friends. Next Sunday is the fourth Sunday in the season of Advent, and it is Christmas Eve, and Joy to the World will be the last hymn that we sing as we move from the Advent season to the Christmas season, as we light the white Christ candle finally and take the light of Christ into the world with us. We'll be singing Joy to the World, the Lord is come. And although the 12 days of Christmas don't actually start until December 25th, the Lord still is come, right? God already did put on flesh and blood and move into the neighborhood. The light of the world has arrived. And yet, in many, many ways, we still live in darkness. That, my friends, is the tension of the Advent season. We know that Jesus has come and the world changed, and yet we are still waiting for that change to be fully realized here on earth as it is in heaven. We know that Christ has won the battle over sin and death, and yet we are still in the midst of the battle. We know that all will be healed and reconciled and whole, and yet we still live in the middle of sickness and division and brokenness. That is why we need Advent. Advent reminds us that we live in the here and not yet of our faith. Salvation is here and not yet fully realized. We remember and we celebrate that Christ has come. That's the birth we prepare to celebrate at Christmas. We celebrate that Christ comes continually in word and in spirit. We anticipate and we prepare for Christ's return and final victory. We anticipate and we prepare. Skipping through Advent and jumping too fast to Christmas is like getting all the ingredients from the store to make a really great meal, and then before you even get home, you open up part of it and you start to eat it. Has anybody else done that before? I have, more than once. Maybe I skipped lunch that day, or I was running around picking kids up and had more kids to pick up, and maybe I would be really hangry if I didn't have at least a little bit of something, right? I get it. Sometimes we just really need Christmas. Maybe it's been a really hard year, and the slow march through Advent, the reflection and the preparation, it just feels too much. And maybe you need Christmas. Maybe you haven't taken the time to properly fuel, nourish, feed your soul. And you're just counting on Christmas to keep you from crashing and burning and completely losing it. I get it. I don't say that just to say it. I get it because I really do understand. There have been some Decembers where I think I cried more than I sang. And even in those seasons, we still need Advent. We need to take the time to prepare the full meal, because those fried onions that you eat on the way home from the store are really nothing compared to the whole green bean casserole, right? We still need to take the time for our soul to be fed well, for the soil to be fully prepared before planting. Our spirits wait for the second coming of Christ. And the season of Advent gets us ready for the full victory feast. Now maybe you're thinking, okay, we get it. Advent. We've talked a lot about Advent. It's Advent. We get it. Yay, it's Advent. The pink candle is this Sunday. It's supposed to be the Sunday of joy. And here we are talking about Advent and hearing from John the Baptist yet again. And we're still singing the depressing Advent hymns. And this does not seem joyful. Where is the joy? Have you ever looked up the definition of joy? Merriam-Webster says that joy is the emotion evoked by well-being, success, or good fortune, or by the prospect of possessing what one desires. It is the state of happiness or felicity. Joy is a source or cause of delight. You see, for those who believe in Jesus Christ, who believe that Jesus is God in flesh, that Jesus, God, came to earth and walked among us to show us how to love and live and give, that Jesus died upon the cross to carry the burdens of the people for all time and reconcile us back to God, who rose from the grave and finally conquered sin and death for eternity. So for those of us who believe in all of that, joy is the emotion evoked by the prospect of complete reconciliation in eternal life with God the Father. Joy is the state of knowing the truth of Jesus Christ. And the source of our joy is Jesus himself. Now, the prophet Isaiah and John the Baptist were both pointing to this coming reality, to the prospect of good news, to the prospect of liberty, and to the prospect of release, pointing to the year of the Lord's favor, to comfort and provision, pointing to justice and righteousness and praise springing forth from all of the nations. Both Isaiah and John the Baptist were pointing to the light of the world. And although we know the story of Christ, we know the story of Jesus, and even people who don't claim Christianity, most people in American culture know the story of Jesus, at least the Christmas part of the story of Jesus. In this day and age, we're still like Isaiah and John the Baptist, pointing to the one who was and who is and forevermore shall be. We are like Isaiah and John the Baptist, pointing to the light so that all may believe. All may believe. And because Christ is within us, we get to be a part of proclaiming the good news. We get to be a part of the liberty and the release of the captives, of proclaiming the Lord's favor, of providing comfort and seeking justice. And we get to watch for righteousness and praise to spring forth from all of the nations. It's Christ with us. It's our joy. It's Christ with us in the midst of it all that is our joy. It's Christ with us and knowing that whatever the heartache and the brokenness and the sickness and the crap of our life is, that that's not the end. It's not the end at all. And that Christ, who came and began a good work in us and who began a good work in the world, is coming again to complete that good work, to finish the good work in us and in the world. So what do we do? Well, if Advent is reminding us to wait, so what do we do while we wait? We wait with anticipation. We wait with hope and peace and joy and love. And in a culture where doing seems to be celebrated to the point of exhaustion, waiting sounds so passive, doesn't it? So how do we wait? Well, this is where John the Baptist helps us out in this season of Advent. As we look at John the Baptist and we lean into his life and his personality, this guy that seems so alive in the midst of his waiting, in the midst of his anticipation. Can you hear his voice if you read the scriptures? Close your eyes for a minute and hear what emotion might be in his voice. He seems almost gleeful as he sort of shakes off the guesses that people throw at him of who he is. Nope, not the Messiah. Mm-mm. Try again. Nope, not Elijah. Try again. Well, then who are you? What are you? They ask him, almost pester him, I think. I'm me. I'm the voice. I'm you. I'm us. All of us. All of us leaning into what is coming. All of us knowing that what is isn't what is going to be. That's who I am. I'm the one who hopes. I'm the one who knows peace. I'm the one who embraces joy with fierceness and tenacity. That's who I am. That's who John the Baptist is. Not just some crazy guy out in the desert. Now, I'm sure some people heard his message out in the wilderness and left. They didn't want repentance. They thought it sounded like some kind of Pollyanna-ish type of whatever and didn't want anything to do with it. Some people, though, heard John the Baptist's message and they stayed. They wanted what he had. They wanted that joy, even if it came with repentance. They came in droves. They waded into the water. They were looking for a new start. They were looking for hope. John kept proclaiming hope, and they looked for hope. And like so many people today, they were desperate for a new way of living. They wanted to feel alive in the world again. John the Baptist? John pointed to the way. John promised that the way and the truth and the life was coming. And his message was not really all that different from the prophet Isaiah's message, which came some 700-ish years before him. Pay attention, the prophet Isaiah said over and over and over. Pay attention. Look at what you're doing to one another. Look at how you're living. Look at the source of your wealth. Look at the foundation of your society. Does your socioeconomic system reflect your status as the people of God? Oh, wait. Years later, Isaiah says, oh, now you're a desperate people who've lost everything. You're hungry and you're afraid and you're homeless. You went from having too much to being refugees without any kind of status or right, exiled into Babylon. So the prophet Isaiah shifts from a call to repentance, just like John the Baptist had, to a call of hope, just like John the Baptist had. Isaiah had a promise that he was proclaiming, a call to live, even in the midst of the desperate times when they felt like they had nothing. Isaiah was still calling the people of God to live by a different standard, to embrace this fierceness of joy that they were the people of God no matter the circumstances that they found themselves in. That didn't matter. They still had joy as the people of God. And so this call of repentance and hope, reflection and joy, this is why we spend the Advent season looking at the prophets and John the Baptist, hearing their call. We need that reminder. We need the reminder of repentance in a season of overconsumption. We need the reminder to wait in a season and a culture of same-day delivery. We need a reminder of doing things God's way when we're used to having it our way. We need that reminder of hope and peace and joy especially when the lights and sounds of Christmas don't match the pain and the desperation and the doubt that's within us and around us. We need that reminder leading up to Christmas. We need to remember that the Lord that brings the good news is coming again. We need the reminder that we, those who know Jesus Christ as our Savior, are blessed, and that that blessing is then lived out in this fierce sense of joy that says, no matter what might happen to me, I know and I choose to trust in God. The end. Period. Full stop. I choose to trust in God. That's fierce joy. Fierce joy says, no matter what my individual feelings and inclinations might be, I am going to join with a community of faith that is doing good in the world. It's that fierce joy that sustains us and encourages us. And I don't just mean like us as me, myself, or us as like this small little group of people here in Meisenheimer, North Carolina. It's this fierce joy of a community of faith larger than just us in this room. It's a shared joy that enables us and allows us to be different in a season of the world where everything rushes full speed ahead. It's a shared joy that allows us to hold the tension of the here and the not yet. It's a fierce joy that allows us to keep going through a long, slow march in the season of Advent as our spirit waits, sometimes impatiently, but waits for the fullness of Christmas that is to come. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. As we continue to lean in to Advent this year, let us sing together, Come Thou Long Expected Jesus. It is hymn number 196 in the Blue Faith We Sing hymnal. A beautiful Advent hymn, and we'll stand in body or spirit as we sing both verses.
Free from our fears.
As we go to God in prayer today, I invite you to be seated or to come and kneel at the rail if you would like. As we pray today, we are all invited to lift the prayers, the needs in the world as we do. And I will say, Lord, in your mercy, and we respond, hear our prayer. But today, I also invite us to lift up the joys in our life, to lift up the places where you have seen God at work, the places where you know a deep sense of God with you in the midst of it. And we will pray with our joys and with our concerns today. And then we'll end together with the Lord's Prayer. So let us pray. Gracious and holy God, we are your people and you are our God. And we come in the midst of this Advent season with all of our hopes and all of our joys and all of our sorrows, all of our hurt, all of our doubts and our fears and our wonders. And so, God, we bring those to you today. Hear us as we lift them all to you, mixed up together, the joy and the sickness, the heartache and the surprise, the happiness, the doubt and the wonder. God, hear us as we lift our joys and our needs to you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Lord, in your mercy, Lord, in your mercy, Lord, in your mercy, Lord, in your mercy. Lord, in your mercy. For unexpected gifts, Lord, in your mercy. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, in your mercy. And for the needs that are so heavy, they just stay stuck in the back of our throat. Lord, in your mercy. And today, God, I also pray for all of us sitting here. Some of us know Jesus, some more intimately than others. And for each of us, God, in this Advent season, draw us near. Draw us near to you and to one another. Let us know in surprising and meaningful and ways we can't ignore, let us know that you are with us, God. And for any who may be sitting here today thinking, I don't know what she is talking about, all this Jesus stuff. But I want to know. I invite us all, those maybe for the first time or for the 10th time or the 100th time, to say in our hearts this simple prayer of salvation, just to say, God, you are God and I am not. You are Savior of the world, and I am not. I'm a sinner. Forgive me for my sins. I believe that the work of Jesus Christ coming into this world, living, dying on the cross, and rising again is sufficient for my salvation. I receive the gift of forgiveness, and I proclaim Jesus as my Lord and Savior. Today, and in the days to come. Jesus, come and live within me. Be my light. Be my salvation. And encourage me to be your light in the world. And now I invite us all to say together the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. When we hear the word of God, we respond not just in song or in prayer, but we can respond in a variety of ways. This Advent season, we have multiple ways that we can walk as disciples of Jesus and point to the light of Christ in the world. One of those ways is the reverse Advent calendar for Stanley Community Christian Ministry. If you'd like to be able to give to their food pantry or our local Good Neighbor pantries, a suggested list of items is on the cart in the back, or you can bring your items and put those on the cart, and we will get those to the proper places. This Wednesday at 11 o'clock, the United Methodist Churches in Northern Stanley County will be leading together a Blue Christmas worship service. We'll gather at 11 at Richfield United Methodist Church, and it will be a time of recognizing joy and hope in the midst of the darkest day, the longest day, or the longest night, the shortest day. We'll have worship and lunch following. And then next Sunday, as we celebrate Christmas Eve, and then the Sunday after, as we have our Christmas hymn sing, we need multiple readers. And so I invite you, if you're going to be here one of those 2 days, and you'd be willing to be a part of leading worship, please let me know after worship, and we'll put your name on the list and get you that information. And then we give with our tithes and our offerings. So as the ushers come and share the offering plates, I invite you to listen to the gift of music that is being offered as well. Ushers.
We didn't announce what we were singing last week, but we hope you've enjoyed our Advent music. We've tried to coordinate really nicely with our Advent season and Chris's beautiful messages. So the first Sunday when we sang Open the Eyes of Our Heart, Lord, was our hope message. And last week, you may have been sitting there wondering, what are they singing? Dona Nobis Pacem means grant us peace, which was our message last week. And for today, as we await in joy, we sing you Christmas Canon.
Merry Christmas, 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 Merry Christmas.
God, you are the giver of all that is good. You are the giver of all the gifts that we receive. And so today, as we return a portion of those gifts to you, we ask that you receive them with a heart of joy. We ask that you give us wisdom to be good stewards of your message in this world, that we might not try to be the light, but we might point to the true light, to the way, the truth, and the life. We ask this in the name of Jesus, the one who is the light of the world. Amen. As we prepare to leave this time of worship and head into the world, pointing to the light of Christmas, we sing number 206. Is that right? Number 206, I want to walk as a child of the light. So let us sing together. That this happens at the end of worship. Often we relegate the task of acolyting to the kids, right? But don't be mistaken of the importance of this role in worship. The light of Christ comes into worship, is with us as we worship, and the light of Christ then goes out and leads us into the world. And if I had my druthers, the acolyte would like run down the aisle and the doors would be open and run outside, because that is the attitude of which we should have when we leave this place. So today, friends, go with joy, following the light of Christ into the world and pointing
to the light of the world. Go with joy in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, as all God's people say, Amen. Amen.